Egypt's civilization is one of the oldest in the world and home to some of the most iconic crafts and traditions. Papyrus, one of the first forms of paper, was invented here and later used by the Greeks. Today, only one village still makes it the ancient way. This red fez hat was once a symbol of the Ottoman Empire. But after it was banned in Egypt in the 1950s, fez making workshops largely disappeared.
إن أنا محافظ على المهنة وولادي طالعين بيحافظوا على المهنة.
We went to Egypt and talked with five artisans who are among the last to keep ancient crafts alive.
This is how cement tiles are handmade at one of the few workshops left in Egypt. The craft has been around since the 1800s, when cement became a cheap and efficient way to build. But for Sayed Hussein, it's an art form. Even though other types of tiles have threatened his business, he's stayed true to his trade. We visited Cairo to see how his workshop is still standing. Sayed has been making tiles since he was 12 years old, and much of his process is still the same.
والله انا بحس ان انا راجل مميز يعني على مستوى مصر كلها دلوقتي ما بقاش في صناعيه انقراض.
He begins with sifting white cement. Once it's become a fine powder, he mixes in pigments to get just the right hue. Working with colors is his specialty.
أنا بركب ألوان واخد بالك بعشق الألوان ديت زي ما بيقولوا كان يقولوا عليا إن أنت بتستطعم اللون وفعلا أنا أبص للون يعني أنا أبص للون كده أقول لك اللون ده بتركيبه إيه وأعرف تركيبته إيه.
Then he adds in water. Sayed pours each color into its own section, using one of his stencils. He's had these for over 35 years.
عادة لما باجي اصب بصب الفواتح الاول اللي هو الرمادي الفاتح الاول اللي هو معايا ده اهو.
He works slowly and precisely to navigate the finer details.
هو اصعب حاجة لما بيبقى الرسم ضيق. لما بيبقى الرسم ضيق وتيجي تحط العجينة لازم تحكم نفسك وتحكم أعصابك ليه؟ عشان العجينة اللي انت بتنزلها ما تنزلش بره الرسم أنا بزق عشان العجينة تلحم في بعضيها تلحم في بعضيها أبدأ إيه؟ أرفع الرسم لازم أرفع الرسم إزاي؟ بسرعة كده أهي كده
Some designs, Sayed does freehand. He tops off the mold with a mixture of sand, cement, and limestone, a crucial step to ensure the pattern stays in place.
الأهم إن البلاطة تتشرب كويس. لازم تتشرب وتاخد حقها في التشريب.
Then he sends it through the hydraulic press. The machine's pressure solidifies the cement within seconds. Sayed learned this craft from his father, who worked at a shop owned by Greek immigrants.
اتعلمتها في ورش كتير ايام ما كانوا الجريك كانوا شغالين فيها وكانوا الجريك هم يعني هم اللي يعتبروا كانوا مسيطرين عليها.
Cement tiles have roots in other parts of Europe, too. Factories started popping up in countries like the UK and France during the 1800s, right after cement was discovered as a cheap and efficient building material. And in Belgium, the industry flourished after World War I. when the country needed rebuilding and cement tiles were an affordable option. Eventually, changing tastes in Europe's tile market pushed cement aside by the mid-20th century. And in Egypt, Syed says ceramic and marble tiles took over the market in the 1990s, shaking up his business.
لأن دي حاجة جديدة واخد بالك والسوق مش هيستحمل ده.
He says since then, the high cost of materials and hard physical labor have steered workers away from the craft.
هو غلو الخامات أولا والصناعية يعني تبص تلاقي الصناعية مش حباها متعبة بتسحب النظر.
Syed was able to stay in business by making new, cheaper designs. Now, he and his two employees are among the few tile makers left. His team can make up to 150 tiles in just a day. They sell 1 square meter of them for 500 Egyptian pounds, or $31, to people around Cairo.
الزباين ديت اللي هم بتوع الكافيهات الطبقات الراقية برضو بالنسبة للفلل بالنسبة للقصور بالنسبة للكافيهات.
Syed has been offering free apprenticeships to young craftsmen for the past 40 years to keep the traditional process going.
هي الصنعة ديت من ساعة ما اتنشأت ما اتغيرتش خطواتها ثابتة لو بعد 1000 سنة هي الخطوات دي هي اللي موجودة.
And he says not just anybody can master it.
هي نفس الشغلة الصنايعي إذا ما كانش فنان مش هيعرف يشتغل فيها.
But the most important thing for Syed is that this art lives on.
ممكن بإذن الله يعني الشغلانة دي تكمل معانا إن شاء الله يعني قول 100 سنة للصناعية تشتغل فيها وتبقى إن شاء الله كويسة.
For 600 years, this machine has been heating and shaping traditional fez hats in Cairo. But businesses like this nearly disappeared when the Egyptian government banned this kind of headwear in the 1950s, part of a sweeping push for modernization. Today, Nasser Abdelbasset is one of the only fez makers left in Cairo. We visited his shop to see how his 130-year-old business is still standing. For over 4 decades, Nasser has been crafting what was once a symbol of Ottoman life.
ده اللي هو التربوش يعني انا بحس ان انا باعه كده اكن عيل من عيالي ما انا متربي معاه متربيين سوا مع بعض.
Every single one is custom made. The first step is to build the structure of the hat. Nasser uses woven straw to craft the base.
برجعهم ايه خلاص اللي فوق ده ملوش لازمة خلاص كده أنا كده ملوش لازمة عندي.
He sprays it with water to make it more malleable.
أهم 3 حاجات عندي في الشغل المية النار الكهرباء. المية علشان الخوصة دي أساسا بتيجي بتجيلي من الرشيد زي ما أنت شايف حضرتك كده مدفرة. بص حضرتك تفتح وتقفل معايا.
To get the right shape, he uses these copper molds. They're more than 6 centuries old.
مش أقدم حاجة عندي في المحل، ده أقدم حاجة في البلد. أقدم حاجة في البلد. أنا بقول لك أرجع للعثمانيين. ما نقدرش نلعب فيها ولا نغير فيها.
Nasser says they once tried to make new machines, but couldn't find any factories that still manufacture the right parts. The inside is lined with green or blue silk. Then it's time to shape the signature red felt.
واحنا طالما احنا بصينا على الهيئه بتاعته 5 دقائق انا بفصل الشغل على الوش بتاع الوش اللي قدام مني. ادخله المكبس ياخد الشكل والاسطمبه بتاعته. أصل لبس التربوش ده في الأول وفي الآخر يا أستاذ الفاضل ها؟ مش لبسه خلاص، لأ. ده بيبقى وقار لي ولصاحبه.
There are several types of fezes. The difference in design depends on who is wearing it. And each one has its own mold, some named after Ottoman rulers.
ده اسمه قالب واحد عثمان. ده قالب محمد علي. ده قالب الأئمة.
Right now, Nasser is making an Azhar fez. It's been worn by Islamic scholars and imams for centuries.
حتة الشولة بتاعتي بتجبرني ان اكون سريع. ليه؟ عشان درجة الحرارة بتاعت النار معايا بتبقى ايه؟ هي اللي مسخنلي جسمي، هي اللي بتجبرني ان انا اكون سريع. ليه؟ ان اي غلطة بجون.
The machine reaches up to 350 degrees Fahrenheit. Figuring out just the right temperature for each hat is a delicate dance.
لازم نسبة الحرارة معايا على النار تكون لازم يكون حد مصحصح لها. إن الغلطة بلسعة. لو خامة حنينة فأنا بحاول أنا أقل في الحرارة عشان خاطر أتعامل معاها برأفة لأنها حنينة. لكن لو خامة محملة أنا ما بتمنيش، حتة السخونة ما بتمنيش.
Nasser glues the felt and straw together. And then his son Muhammad handles the finishing touches. Colored tassels used to signify different professions. This white fabric is unique to the Azhar fez. Today, it's a more traditional look reserved for religious leaders. But the fez was once much more widespread. It was a defining symbol of the entire Ottoman Empire that rose to power in the 14th century and controlled large swaths of Europe, Africa, and the Middle East at its peak. In the early 19th century, Sultan Mahmud II wanted to modernize society by phasing out the turban and requiring all Ottoman men to wear the fez instead. So people who preferred sticking to tradition began wrapping a turban around a fez, similar to the Azhar style Nasser makes today. But by the time the Ottoman Empire fell in 1922, the fez was considered old-fashioned. Turkey's first president wanted to westernize his people by replacing the traditional Ottoman headpiece with the European top hat. And by 1925, wearing a fez in Turkey was punishable by a month in prison. But most Egyptians still embraced fez styles well into the 1950s. That's until Egyptian President Gamal Abdel Nasser, seen here wearing a military fez, banned them in 1958 after leading the revolution.
طربوش اللي لغاه عبد الناصر. بس ما قدرش يجي جنب ده. ان ده خط احمر.
Nasser mostly sells to Islamic studies professors, religious leaders, and movie producers. Today, it's just Nasser and his son running the shop. They can make up to 100 fezes in a day, but usually orders are well under that. But he remembers hearing stories about a time when business was booming.
كانش المحل ده كان قد كده مرتين ثلاثة كان بره على الشارع. ما كان المحل كان يفتح 8 الصبح يقفل 8 بالليل. ما كانش ليه؟ لأن كان حتة الاستعمال ولبس دايرة. ما كناش بنلاحق على الزباين زمان.
Still, Nasser is preserving a craft that not many wanted to continue.
إن أنا محافظ على المهنة وولادي طالعين بيحافظوا على المهنة. في طربشية قفلوا إن أولادهم مش عايزين يكملوا فيها.
And customers can rest assured that his son plans to carry on his legacy.
بدليل أنا مثلا لما الزبون بياخد شغل من محمد بيتصل بيا بيقول لي ناصر الصغير أنا خدت شغل من ناصر الصغير. ده وسام على صدري.
This is one of the last places in the world that makes papyrus paper. People in this small Egyptian village reinvented the ancient process in the 1970s, and the industry thrived selling papyrus art to tourists. But today, there's little demand for the paper, and the plant is nearly extinct in Egypt. Those that remain are determined to carry on this piece of Egypt's history. We visited El Karamus to see how the ancient craft is still standing. Atef Mohammed Shahaita spends about 2 hours harvesting papyrus by hand from the single acre he owns. It takes a year for a papyrus seedling to grow to this size. After it's cut down, it grows back in 1 or 2 months. At one point, the village's land was filled with the plant. But today, there are only 10 acres left. Atef carries the plant about a mile to his workshop, where he employs 7 people. They chop the stalks based on the size they want the paper. Then, workers spend the entire day cutting the papyrus into thin strips using a fishing line. This method is more efficient than the ancient process.
كان عشان يشرخوا بيشرخوا بالسكينة احنا عادنا فتلة خيط بلاستيك.
But it's still exhausting.
مسكة الخيط كده ومسكة العود يعني مش سهلة مش أي حد يعرف يعملها.
The strips soak in hot water mixed with potassium hydrate for a couple days. The chemicals speed up the fermentation process.
بنشرخ بيها. عادنا التخمير كان زمان هما بخمروا. بيبطي أسبوع واثنين احنا بنعد من الخمر يوم واثنين.
Then they rinse the strips with water and chlorine to lighten the color.
اللون الورق كانت غامقة عندهم احنا حدنا صنعنا اللون بالكرول عاد عندنا كرول بيدينا اللون الفاتح والغامق بنتحكم فيه يعني.
Workers lay out the wet papyrus strip by strip. Each sheet of paper has 2 layers, one vertical and one horizontal, to strengthen it. Then the stack goes into the compressor to dry.
كان زمان ايام الفراعنه كان لما بيجي يكبسوا الورق بقى يجيبوا حجاره ويكبسوها احنا حدانا مكابس.
After that, the sheets are sandwiched between pieces of cardboard to soak up any leftover moisture.
100% كده الورقه نشفت اهي. كده خلصت على الغيار، كده تمام، نحطه في كيس ونعد الورق لايه مثلا واحد عايز مثلا 500,000 ورقه بنديها له.
Atef sells the paper to artists across the village, including Saeed Tarahan. He started out farming the plant, and today he works as an artist.
فتعال واخد لك شوف شتله واخد لك صغيره واخد لك مزروعه شفتها واخد لك بدات تكبر والموضوع بدا يعني ايه نكبر معاه. اكبر فتره من عمري وانا بمارس بقت جزء مني.
But since the COVID-19 pandemic put a halt on tourism, he struggled to find a market. He had to close down his shop and lay off his workers just a couple weeks ago. Now he works out of his home.
مفروض واخد بالك ان ده شكل انوبس موجود على خزنه، خزنه توت عنخ امون ادي اسمه موجود وانوبس واخد بالك على خزنه ده مقطع منه المفروض ان صندوق المجوهرات بتاعه وده واخد بالك هنبدا واخد بالك نملا مساحات ونعمل شكله اللي موجود في الاصل يعني.
All of Saeed's paintings include ancient Egyptian motifs to pay homage to papyrus's origin.
كان ليها عند الفراعنه واخد بالك تاريخ وليها قيمه احنا حاسين بيه وعشان كده واخد بالك يعني لان دي قصه وتاريخ فاحنا محتفظين واخد بالك بالكلام ده وعارفين قيمته.
Egyptians invented papyrus paper at least 5,000 years ago, replacing clay tablets and revolutionizing the written word. They used it for things like marriage contracts and shopping lists. They also turned the plant into a weaving material for sandals and baskets. Cheaper paper made from wood pulp or plant fibers eventually replaced papyrus paper, and the plant became nearly extinct in Egypt by the early 1800s, until an art professor and an engineer brought back seeds from other African countries in the 1970s. They set up plantations and workshops in El Karamus. And papyrus became the center of the local economy.
الورق البردي لما نزل قرموس احنا اشتغلنا فيه كان احنا بنزرع اراضينا قمح لقينا هو افضل من زرع القمح يعني بيكسب.
Almost everyone in the village was involved with processing raw materials or making artwork to sell to tourists. Said got into papyrus because his cousin was the art professor who helped revive it. He remembers it as a turning point for the village.
فدي وخدك هي زراعة جديدة لكن أثرت فينا وخدك يعني اقتصاديا المردود والعائد الاقتصادي وخدك والثقافي والاجتماعي لا غيرتنا وخدك بالطبع كان تغيير وخدك للأحسن.
But after the Arab Spring uprisings in 2011, tourism in Egypt crashed. The country saw a 63% drop in visitors over the following years through 2016. And the market for papyrus paper nearly vanished. A decade later, the industry had just started to recover when the pandemic hit. Said has gotten just one order in the past week. A painting like this normally sells to tourist shops for 50 Egyptian pounds, or $3. Bigger and more detailed pieces go for up to 500 Egyptian pounds, or $32. But with sales down, Said has had to work another job to keep his business afloat. And he says he'll do everything he can to save the art.
الناس أصبحت وخدت النهاردة بقت حاجة أساسية جدا في حياتنا. لا ما ينفعش، ما ينفعش. شعوري أنا الشخصي وخدت في حالة إن أنا يعني هحس وخدت إن أنا افتقدت حاجة مهمة جدا جدا في حياتي.
Atef is also determined to keep Egypt's history alive.
دي مش حكايه فلوس ان هي يم جدي وابويا ان هي موجودين واحنا تربينا عليها يعني ازعل جامد ان انقرضت الورق البردي يعني.
And with Egypt's tourism industry expected to recover this year, Said is holding out hope for papyrus.
انا توقعي وخدت انه لهذه الحرفه الازدهار ان شاء الله. بدليل حجم المتاحف اللي بتنشأ وخدك في مصر وهي عموما السياحة في مصر تمرض ولا تموت.
Soaking yarn by hand is the ancient method this dye house has been using for over a century. It's one of the last in Egypt, a country long known for its textile industry.
أنا بشتغل شغلتي دلوقتي أيام الفراعنة.
Salama Selam has been the one keeping the vats full and the fires burning since 1975, even as industrial competition and the global pandemic have threatened his livelihood. We first visited the workshop in 2019 and came back to see how it's weathering the pandemic. Through it all, one man's love for the craft has kept this tradition still standing. Salama begins a batch by prepping the yarn. He separates the white threads into sections.
أنا دي شغلتي. فبنقض له التخيل لوحده وبنقض له الرفيع لوحده. لما يروح يشتغل يعرف إن ده لوحده وده لوحده.
Then his sons mix dye with water that's just the right temperature. The hotter the water, the brighter the color. It takes two people to dunk the yarn into the 40-year-old stone basin. And drag it through the dye. Once the threads are completely saturated, it's time to wring them out using a spinning machine. At about 15 years old, it's the only modern piece of equipment in the workshop. After a few minutes, the yarn is hung out to dry on the roof of the workshop for about 2 hours. Then it's packaged and shipped to customers all over the world.
لمصلحة السهول وبزبغ للجيش ويعني وبزبغ لناس في أمريكا وبزبغ لناس في إسرائيل دلوقتي حاليا وفي فلسطين وفي سوريا وفي لبنان.
It's a family operation that often involves Salama's 12 children and many of his more than 40 grandchildren.
احساسي بان انا ببقى مبسوط وفرحان بان كلهم بيتلموا عندي وبيشتغلوا معايا وبيتعلموا وبعدين الصنعه مش وحشه الصنعه حلوه.
Salama has tried out a handful of professions and he even served in the military for 9 years before settling on dyeing. Now he's been running the dye house for 45 years.
كرهت كل حاجه الا المسبغ.
Today, business has been slower than usual since the spread of COVID-19. But it doesn't stop Salama from putting in the work.
حالة تعبانة شوي لكن ماشية يعني أنا بقوم من النوم الساعة 4 الصبح واخد بال حضرتك عشان أجي أشتغل وأكل عيالي.
The workshop's small-scale operation has made it hard to keep up with mass manufacturers. Most textile dyeing in Egypt and around the world today happens at larger industrial-scale factories. About 70 miles west of Salama's workshop, Chinese investors announced in 2019 the construction of what would be one of the largest textile zones in the country. The COVID-19 pandemic has slowed the project, but once in full swing, investors expected to bring in more than $8.5 billion a year. Meanwhile, Salama's sales have been dropping for more than a decade. They fell nearly 60% in 2011, after the Arab Spring protests rocked the Egyptian economy. Today, fuel prices are still too high for Salama's margins. So he cuts costs by using wood instead of gasoline to make fire and heat his dye vats. Though it might be more physically taxing, he takes pride in this traditional method.
شوف الفراعنة ماتت بقى لها كام سنة أنا بشتغل شغلتهم دلوقتي. ما بشتغلش غير شغلة الفراعنة. الفراعنة كانوا بيشتغلوا بخشب اشتغلت بالخشب.
Salama's ancient techniques are what keep many of his customers loyal.
احنا عندنا هنا لغاية دلوقتي لغاية وقتنا هذا في ناس فلاحين وناس صعايدة وناس عرب بيلبسوا الجلابية البلدي اللي هي بإطار وبشريط من الديل وشريط من الجنب غير حضرتك فدلوقتي حاليا ما بيجوش غير هنا.
But his regular clients that usually put in orders every month have dropped off to every 2 or 3 months since the start of the pandemic. Still, Salama is determined to keep this business alive for as long as he possibly can.
عايز اموت وانا بشتغل. وما يكونش عليا حاجه لحد. ده اللي نفسي فيه.
Egyptians in Luxor have been carving stones for thousands of years. And for Sayed Mahmoud Al-Matani, sculpting is a way to tell his country's history through art. He inherited the craft from his father and grandfather and has been doing it for over 6 decades.
يعني احنا عندنا ثروة قومية ويجب الحفاظ عليها لأن مصر مليئة بالخيرات وإذا استغلناها استغلال حقيقي صح.
In the past, craftsmen carved hieroglyphics and intricate figures of people, animals, and gods. They used stone to make everyday items, but also the tombs of their kings and queens. Today, artisans mostly make souvenirs and ornaments, like vases and jewelry boxes. But political turmoil in Egypt and the pandemic impacted Sayed's business. And tourism, his biggest source of income, virtually disappeared for 2 years. We went to Luxor to see how, despite hardship, this ancient craft is still standing. At 75, Sayed prefers to take on complex tasks, like carving details into miniature pieces. He's eager to pass on the craft to younger generations, and so he trains apprentices like Ahmad, who's been doing this job with him for 13 years. First, they cut the block of stone with a saw. Then Ahmad breaks it with a hammer to get it to the size he wants to work with. If he's working with a large piece, like a vase, he places it in a hole in the ground that keeps it in place. He switches to a hand-powered drill to hollow a core for the vase. It can take him up to 5 days to do this step alone.
بكون ده طبق فأنا بركحت له حفرة بتمسكها زي حجام. بعد كده بنحط عليها شوية من التراب زي كده ونعملها عملية تفريغ من الداخل بالآلات اليدوية زي كده.
Egyptians have been carving stone since the earliest dynasties 5,000 years ago. Almost all of the stone-built tombs can be found west of the Nile River, in the burial site called the Valley of the Kings. pharaohs commissioned vast statues that were meant to glorify them in life and death. And skilled craftsmen quarried the deserts to build them. It took years to finish constructing and carving these ancient monuments. But as new materials emerged, the use of stone dwindled. Even though modern tools are available today, Syed prefers the simple carving methods similar to those his ancestors used.
هو اللي يشتغل بالمواد الكهربائية ما يطلعش حاجة صح. لازم الهاند ميد. الفراعنة أن استعمل الحاجة بدون ميكنة فطلع مظبوطة، لكن احنا ما نجيب مواتير ودي يخرم دي ودي لا 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 ما ينفعش.
Once the center is done, Ahmad uses a file to even out the surface.
في نوعين ما بارد أو ثلاثة، في مبرد اللي هو زي كده بالشكل دي برضه الشفته بتاعت الحته بنحددها. بعد ما تنتهي المبرد تكون شكلك في نوع شنفره تدينا طبقه انعم.
He then sands the base with a softer sander to do the finish. Finally, he cleans it with water. Making one vase like this takes Ahmad 10 days. Larger items can take months to finish. These pieces sell anywhere from $300 to $1,000. Syed devoted his life to a craft that he inherited. But his real interest began as a kid, when he stumbled upon ancient carvings while playing with his friends.
كنا نطلع من المدارس ونروح نلعب كوره في المقابر في المعابد يعني ما كانش يعني ما كانش في حد فازاي وصلوا كده ازاي عملوا كده ازاي وصلوا كده فانا بدات يعني زرعت في دماغي.
He's mastered hieroglyphics by carving them into figurines and vases. And he often refers to books to match the original inscriptions.
يعني احنا بنستعين ببعض المجلدات عشان نعرف نشتغلها صح. يعني انت عشان تعمل ده صح لابد شفت ازاي؟ اهو شوف.
Syed works with different types of stones, like the Egyptian alabaster, granite, and basalt. Some of them go through a burning process to harden the pieces. And it's all done outside. Syed uses cow dung to create the perfect ground for stone burning. Larger ones can stay in the fire for at least 24 hours. More than half the people in Luxor work in the tourism industry. And most of Syed's customers are tourists who are often looking for vases and sculptures depicting Egyptian gods. But the 2011 Egyptian revolution and protests kept foreign visitors away. And then the pandemic made things even worse.
بس يعني فيش اجانب بيجوا كتير يعني انا كان ما يمرش علي يومين ويجوا اجانب يوم ثاني يجوا ناس اجانب من المانيا من امريكا يعني بيجوا من كل حته.
Syed also works as a farmer to make ends meet. But his passion is stone carving.
أنا بفخر بأي حاجة أعملها بس أكون عملتها على صح. هتجيب مادة إيه؟ مش مشكلتي. مش هتجيب مادة مش مشكلتي. بس أنا أهم حاجة أعمل الصح.
Working in a craft that has lasted thousands of years, he knows the hard times will pass. So he's determined to pass on his skills to the next generation.
لا مش هتندثر إن شاء الله، لا لا لا. في شباب طالعين كويسين يعني بس عاوزين محاباه شويه كده يرعوا لهم يعني اه يعني